going to go on ahead and smudge the space, our space, creating sacred space here with sage. So as I'm burning my sage, the flower of sage, the plant of sage, is a very ancient and sacred plant. And our ancestors have left this for us to continue to use. And sage is the most exploited plant and unethically harvested plant in the world right now. So as we're burning our sage, I'm gonna ask the most proper way to do it, to give respect with sage, is to burn a leaf. You can smudge an entire circle with one leaf of sage. Burning your bundles, if you're not harvesting yourself or planting yourself, you're basically following along with something that's been exploited to an ancient sacred plant. So I'm just gonna smudge myself in the space I'm in. I'm gonna blow it towards the screen to welcome in safe space, sacred space with all of us. I'm using a feather with some carnelian and clear quartz. This feather was made by Amora. So I just wanted to call her out since I'm using her tool. And when you're saging, you want to do your crown around the surfaces, your feet. And for your home, you can do the corners of your home as well. And around your door, your doorways. Okay. So again, for those of you who are joining, this is Sisters in Business Table Talks, episode one. Our pilot, I've been calling a lot of things because it's the first one. And so I humbly, my heart loves you. My soul adores you. My crown receives you for joining me and my sisters here today. We are on a vacay. We are on a vacay, and we're all together in the same space on a beachfront property. If you see us with tribal markings, it's because we just did a goddess photo shoot and dance led by Zanetta Tribble, who's on the panelist today. And so we're keeping our tribals on for you and for us, because it feels good. And so thank you for being here and for allowing space in your time to be with me and to be with us as we speak about business and just thriving as a woman, a sister, and any of the brothers who are on, thriving as a brother, as an entrepreneur as well. Because sisters, when we do things ourselves, we are fantastic. We're blowing it out of the water. But when we add our brother to it, we are dynamically powerful. So that's the yin, the yang, the masculine, the feminine. And we can do things on our own, but we can also do things together as well. So I just want to call that out. As people are still attending, again, this is a sacred space. This is what I would call a sister circle for business entrepreneurs. What I'm gonna do now that we've smudged the space, I'm gonna call in the four elements, and then I'm gonna guide you to put your hand on the chakra space for each of those elements. I can stand, but I don't know if you'll be able to see it through the screen. Okay, so what we're gonna do is I'm just gonna put my hands out, welcome in the different elements, and thank them for joining our circle. And then that opens our circle and it casts our circle. So if you can, for me, please, wherever you are, make sure you're grounded. So either your root chakra, which is just below your tailbone, is properly placed, or your feet are grounded on the floor close to earth as possible. If you want to stand up, you can stand up and do that as well. Okay. So, and it's going to require some breathing. So this isn't like your traditional business webinar. Okay. We are setting space in your businesses. When you come together to commune, you should always open sacred space. Always open sacred space. So we're going to do that now. So I'm putting my hands up and I'm going to call in the energies of the East, energies of air. Thank you to the birds, the vultures that just coast on the air. They don't even flap their wings. They just use the air to propel them. We give thanks for your wisdom. We give thanks for your movement. And so energy of air, we're going to put on our heart. That's our center. And we're going to welcome in the East and the element of air to our sacred circle. And we're going to take a deep breath in and breathe out. And bring our hands back together and then put out. Energies of the West, elements of water, we thank you for joining our sacred circle. We thank you for movement. We thank you for the hip movement. We thank you for the blood that flows through our bodies. As women, we give thanks for the blood that coordinates with the moon, that brightens, enlivens earth. We are connected. And without water, we don't grow. Without water, we don't move. Much thanks to the West, energies of water. And we're going to breathe in and out. Thank you for entering our sacred circle. Energies of the South, energies of fire. Oh, one thing that I forgot to, sorry about that. With the water, that's the sacral chakra. So the sacral chakra, you will put right here underneath your belly and right here. So this is our energy of water. This is our West. And if you're standing when we were doing West, you can always just move your hips because that's all about movement. Okay. So now we're going to South, which will be if you're standing on your feet or your right here, your tailbone, you could put your hand on that chakra. That's the root chakra, element of fire. So elements of the South, elements of fire, we welcome you into our sacred circle. We welcome you and thank you for your ignition, for igniting us, the flames that keeps us moving, the flames that keeps us fiery to get things done. Energies of the South, energies of fire. We welcome you into our sacred circle and we breathe in and exhale. Energies of the North. We welcome you into our sacred circle. Energies of Earth. So that also is our root chakra. Root chakra is fire as well. So we can also put our hands again on our tailbone. Thank you for the energies of fire. Thank you for the trees. Thank you for nature. Thank you for growing. Thank you for giving us everything that we have and for being in commune and alignment with us. And we welcome you into our sacred circle and we breathe in and out. And now we're going to put our hands above, giving thanks to above. Thank you for the energies of our angels, our guided ascended masters. We thank you for your guidance. Thank you for always looking over us. Thank you for always checking us. And with that, we welcome you into our sacred circle, and we breathe in and breathe out. Now we're gonna go down to earth and put our hands as far as we can on the floor. If you're outside, we could put it on the dirt. We give thanks to below, deep down in the soil, where wisdom, where the ancient ancestors are, whipping up the medicine, whipping up everything that will transcend us into wealth and health. We give thanks and welcome you into our sacred circle, energies of wisdom. We thank you and welcome you. And we lift our hands up and breathe in and out. And we go back to our heart center. This is our sacred space, the heart. The heart is the center. So we welcome in our sacred space, energies of the heart. We welcome you into our circle. Thank you for the beat. Thank you for the continuance. Thank you for the feeling of emotions. Thank you for allowing us to be free in experiencing each and every emotion for every day and every experience, whether good, whether bad, all is divine. And we thank you for covering that. We welcome you into our sacred circle. We put our hands up and breathe and let go. And I open my eyes and lay my hands out to all of you. And our circle is cast to speak about business, entrepreneurship, and the sacred sisterhood. And I welcome you, and I ask that you welcome us, and that you receive us as we receive you, without judgment, just being, and being happy to be reflections of each other. So that is my honoring and opening to each of you. So for those of you who have just joined, I am Tamika Petrie of Tamika Petrie LLC. Under Tamika Petrie LLC is Meek Silent Retreats. I'm also a Reiki teacher. I also have launched this year strategic business planning and coaching, which this falls up underneath that. The purpose of Sisters in Business Table Talks is to share our stories, to make business talk the new gossip, to make business talk the new tea, if you will, amongst us and amongst our communities, and to spread that. The more we speak about business and share our ups and downs about it, the more in our community we'll build businesses. We will encourage each other. We can share resources without fear that they're going to take our clients or whatever those programming messages that's been conditioned into our mind. We are here for every success that we've have, for every experience that we go through, and we overcome it and we're still here. That wasn't for you. It's for everyone that we're bringing up behind us. And that's what Sisters in Business Table Talks are about. We're gonna hold your hand. We're gonna share our stories. We're gonna help you with resources. And if we don't have it right now, we know the people or resources who can help you with it. And again, I'm happy to have you here with me. And I am going to start introducing the panel. Let me see how I do this. Bear with me. This is my first one. The webinars are much different. So anyone who's on here in business who use Zoom for meetings, when you transition into webinar, so this is the first shared experience, the webinar is totally different. The bugs and buttons and whistles and everything is much different from the meeting. So just bear with me as I maneuver through that. So Zanetta, you're the first that I'm seeing here. I'm going to turn that over to you.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Zanetta Tribble, and I'm the owner and founder of Tribal Waste Beads. So Tribal Waste Beads is a return to ancient African tradition and sacred adornment. I started creating waste beads in 2012, and I wanted it to be something that was activating and awakening that goddess within us all. And again, returning back to our ancient roots, it's very important to do that because we were disconnected from that, and just be more empowered and whatever healing tools sisters may need. So that was really the purpose behind creating Tribal Waste Beads. And it's been 8 amazing years. You know, this journey has been amazing in business, and I'm constantly learning. Tamika, I greatly appreciate you for creating this platform for us all to get together and share our business journeys, as well as to continue learning. Anyone interested in learning more about my business and what it is that I do, you can reach me on IG or Facebook as Tribal Waste Beads. And I also have a website, tribalwastebeads.com. So, Zanetta.
My name is Heather. I'm an intuitive energy worker, a master Reiki practitioner, and a life coach. My life and passion is to help people navigate on their sacred path and to transform positive energy into higher consciousness. Currently, I am the executive director of Project Know Thyself Liberation Movement, and I am also the owner of Sacred Grounds Coffee House. I also conduct various training seminars and workshops in the areas of spiritual healing with young folks, seminars like Get Tough, Get Serious, Get Educated, and a number of other things. I am delighted to be here today. I've known Tamika for a while, and I'm just very thankful to be on this panel. So give thanks.
I am Destiny DeWalt. I am the owner and founder of Simply Destiny Unique and the subsidiaries under that particular company is Yonikonomics, which is a program that I developed to help women heal through inherited trauma and lived trauma and how to move it through their bodies using Tibetan and African Tantra, which incorporates weaving, sound, light, and movement in your body to help release blockages and pain and to move forward in your life. I am also a doula, and which is something that came out of Yonikonomics because we want to help women create safe spaces in their bodies so that when they have children, the children inherit less trauma. So just creating these gateways for the next generation to have less to work through. I also operate a program called Redefining Our Love with my partner, who I've been with for 15 years, just really trying to help African-American families, in particular, and couples navigate relationship by first getting to know ourselves and what we mean to each other as individuals and as partners. And I will be launching a product line, hopefully by this fall, called Dee's Novelties, which is another program that me and my partner will be doing.
Awesome. Hello, I am Christina Lane. Thanks again for Tamika for inviting me to the panel. It's greatly appreciated. I, myself and my husband are in the business of higher education in the timeless profession of barbering. And so we train people to become skilled in barbering. But not only skilled in barbering, we also have an entrepreneurial component to that, because that is a significant piece in being a successful barber. If you're looking for something that's going to yield longevity, it's a very entrepreneurial craft because there's many directions one can take. We also have a personal development program that's included in our program as well, because we know that personal development and professional development go hand in hand, and you really can't be your best professional self if you're not taking care of yourself or nurturing the things within that you need to nurture in order to reach your highest level. And so we'll get more into this when we talk about the pivot, but we are pivoting thanks to COVID. And so we're branching out to add something for the world, not only barbers. And so I'm excited to share that when the time comes.
Yay. Give thanks. Greetings. I am Botany Kalfani. I am an artist, a creator of many artistic avenues. I'm a designer, I'm a dancer, actor, writer, speaker. I have a clothing line called Botany Kalfani, which is my couture line for women. And I also have a line called The Seduction Awaits, which is a ready-to-wear line for women, and also a men's line that is coming out, and a mask site that was created during this whole quarantine thing, this coronavirus thing, that's called mask.world. And basically, I'm just an overall creator. So thank you for having me, and I look forward to sharing my jewels and business.
Thanks.
Hello, everybody. I am Alicia Monet, and I am a creatress. I'm a psycho-spiritual surgeon, and I am an artist. So I do tarot. That's how I introduce my psycho-spiritual services, through the art of tarot. And I create bath and body products, bath salts, and body scrubs and whipped shea butters in order to help to heal. I also do for women to help heal with sexual trauma. I have developed orgasmic breath and feminine flow. That's something that I'm gonna be relaunching soon. I launched that a couple of years ago, but as we get into the story of business and coming into business and all of that, we can get into how that is going to be relaunched. And yeah, I just create all sorts of things, tools to help heal on a psycho-spiritual level, like dream catchers and things of that sort. So yeah, I'm so excited to be here. I'm really happy and I'm excited to see how this goes. Thank you for having me.
So that is our panelists. And I know that took a little while. We have more topics that are coming up. So this vision is something that when I launched my strategic planning business, the beginning of this year, it's probably more around the end of the year of last year. I had this vision to do, Sisters in Business table talks, but the vision was for, a sister to host sisters at her home, and we like sit around the coffee table on pillows or the sofa and just talk business. And I wanted to like record it and put it on like Facebook Live. And then, you know, our new way of living happened with COVID-19, and we couldn't do that. So I stopped thinking about it, and spirit kept saying, don't abandon, don't abandon. I'm like, well, how the heck am I supposed to do it? Because we got to be together. And so the more I kept getting the voices saying, do not abandon this, it hit me to maybe do like a live stream, and where we could still hold space for each other and speak about business and create the same vibe. And so that's why we're all here. And again, I'm going to say thank you for joining. We had a lot of people register, and on the registration was where you could ask any questions or things that you wanted to know before the webinar started, for us to be prepared. Before I get to those, I just wanted to say that for those of you who are joining, because we had like 32 registrants and it's my first time using webinar, I did, I don't know what the word is called, but, I'm not going to say muted, but you're not going to see yourself on the screen. Because then I would have like all these boxes of people, and I felt it was going to make it difficult for me to keep, a track on my panelist and myself. But what you do have the ability to do is speak when I unmute you. So there's also a Q&A. If you have questions, you can click on that Q&A button. I think it's at the bottom. And I believe some people have been posting in the chat box as well, letting me know that you're here, but you can't see yourself. So that's why you can't see yourself. Once I get a little bit more familiar by the next webinar, I might be able to do that depending on how busy the traffic is or not. So, but while we're here, I do want to address the sisters who took time to, and brothers who took time to express what questions that they had beforehand, and respect them by answering those now. So one of them, Ty Amy, I don't know, Ty, if you're on yet or not, but we're gonna answer your question, so then maybe you can hear the response to that when you listen to the playback. So Ty's question, her name of her business is Have a Heart Foundation. It's a nonprofit foundation. And her question is, she wanted to know about resources for nonprofits. So if there are any annual forms or taxes or anything like that, that's annual, that she needs to know about. The other question that she had is wanting to know if there are any business development mentorship programs for sisters and brothers starting out with their nonprofit business. So none of us on the panel here can speak to that, but we have resources. And I have a beloved resource who's on the line as an attendee. She's like my second mother. Let's see if I could see her here. Oh no, did we lose her? Okay, I think we may have lost her. So if she joins back in, we will get her.
I can refer a resource to Mika.
Okay, if she does come on, we'll have her, because she actually sits on the, for the city of Los Angeles, she sits on the 501c3 board. So, and she was on a Zoom meeting when I was asking her about that with them today. So I was like, ooh, perfect timing. So Bhatini, you can share your resource, but I would really like for Norma and Tume to provide some guidance for nonprofit as well.
So I have a friend named Ifu Nanyan Nweke. She does nonprofit management, and you can contact her at jazzhandsforautism.org. That's jazzhands with the S for autism.org. And she helps nonprofits from beginning to end through the whole phase of just getting funding and taxes and everything like that. So her name is Ifu Nanya Nweke, Nweke. And her website is jazzhandsforautism.org. So you could go there and contact her and she will help you out.
Awesome, thank you. The next question from Monique West. I don't know if Monique is on here. But her question is how to handle shipping and get more advertising online when the owner has an underlined condition and cannot travel. So my response to that, so there's a lot of ways to handle shipping, especially when you can't travel. Now, they did this before, but became very important and user-friendly with COVID-19, where the USPS, you can print your own postage. And if you know the size and stuff of your box or whatever shipment you have, you could put in what that weight is and it'll print out a packaging for you, the slip, and you can put it on your package and they'll come and pick it up. I know a lot of businesses who have been using that lately, more so than they did before. I think before they would just go to the post office or what have you, but a lot of people, businesses have been using that way. So Bhatini and Zanetta, I'm gonna see if you have any comments on that too. So Bhatini, I'm seeing your face now. So if you want to unmute yourself.
So just with you, what you said, the pre-shipping labels can be printed and put on the packages, and whenever the postal service comes, they can come pick it up. And then also you can possibly hire someone to, you know, get the packages and take them to the post office if you feel better about that. But yeah, the shipping labels really help. You can go on your website or whatever is attached to your business and
get the prepaid shipping labels, do it right there, tape it on, and it's done, and it's easy.
Yeah.
And so, yeah.
Okay. Zanetta or Alicia, any input you have that's a little different or something more creative or something that we haven't spoken about yet? Okay.
Yeah, I don't have anything beyond what Batani shared. I was going to suggest the same thing, but even going further with hiring an assistant, if that's something that would be more helpful, to even come in and assist you with that and getting your package together, doing the pre-shipping labels and all of that, and then taking them to the post office for you. That's very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. So thank you guys for sitting through that. I wanted to get that business out of the way for those folks who, there was another question, but it wasn't really a question, but I'm gonna go over that really quick so I can acknowledge this person. Shu Oceani, Temple, she wanted a template or examples for our schedule and what she should focus on for the day. And she doesn't have a team. So there's no templates here. I do have a schedule on my website. It's currently being updated. So each of the topics will have its own registration. So anyone that one of the topics resonates with them, they can go ahead and register for that particular topic and for their needs. But me, myself, I do have templates, but this Sisters in Business Table Talks is a casual conversation. Templates aren't required. You don't need anything. Only thing you need to come prepared with is ready to learn, ready to listen, ready to engage in the conversation, have questions if you have questions, and most importantly, feel free to ask those questions. In this circle, for those of you who are on at the beginning, it's casted. So it's sacred, meaning no one's going to judge you. There's no stupid or crazy question, and no one's going to do a cross eye, like, well, why does she or he ask that stupid question? Not here. And to just let you know how serious I am about sacred space, and anyone who's attended any of my retreats where I've had to say anything, you know that, I'm very protective of the circle. I am Mia Four. I hold spirit of Queen Mother, and I really do have that spirit. So I am loving and I am nice, but at the same time, I shut it down to protect the circle. So the same goes here. Each and every one of you are held in sacred space with strong, loving Nana arms. And so here in this space with Tamika Petrie and anyone that I've invited into this circle, you are free to express whatever you want to express here. Now, when you leave and go somewhere else, I can't say that, but within in here, you can. So I just wanted to, you know, to bring that up and let you know that you're safe here. Now, what I'm thinking I want to do, Christine, I'm seeing, okay, so I have a question from Athena. Athena is also going to be on one of our panelists coming up on another sister in Sisters in Business Table Talks that I haven't scheduled yet. What I found is that a lot of the guests that I invited, just about all of them pick Sisters in Business Table Talks. And so I wanted to keep the panel at least no more than four people on the panel. This one is bigger because we're all together in one space. So I figured it was, you know, proper. So I'm going to be rescheduling. So Athena will definitely be one of those. So her question is, what are the most useful tools that you're using in your business that has helped you? I'm going to speak for me first, Athena, on that. So for the past 21 years, I've worked in corporate America and I'm still working in it. And I've carried the roles as business development, process improvement, project management, Six Sigma Lean process improvement methodologies. So what I did when I started learning project management and working in that arena, I didn't have a business of my own then, but I was thinking, well, yeah, I'm an artist. I was painting. And so I was like, oh, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to paint as much as I can in the next 6 months. And then I am going to get me a tax ID number and I'm going to create me a gallery. And before I test that, before I really go full-fledged with it, I'm going to do a research and analysis. So I am going to take my tax money. So this is me at 30, I don't know how old I was, 30 something, in the early 30s, probably 31 or something. I don't know how old I was. So I'm going to take my tax money. I'm going to buy me a booth at the African-American, at the African fair. I forgot what it was called because they stopped doing them. And see if people like my art and if they buy it. And if they like it, what do they like about it? What brought them to my booth? So I was like collecting all this data. So that's a tool because that's something I took because in corporate America, they do these trial runs or these beta testings or these pilots. And from that, they collect data, like what worked, what didn't work. Was it, did anybody get it? Do we have to go all the way back to square one? If this worked and this is what attracted people to it, then that's something we're doing good. We need to expand on that. If it's something that nobody got or whatever, why didn't they get it? So now that's what I need to turn around. That's what I have to improve now before I bring it to market. So without thinking, just using some of the tools that I learned from my corporate job, I was applying them to all of my ideas. Because if I had a vision, I'm implementing it. I'm doing it. So I used a lot of project management tools. I used a lot of strategic planning tools, especially when I got into multi-annual strategic planning. And those tools helped me understand what I didn't know then because I was just in it, but I didn't understand until I started speaking to other sisters and brothers about their businesses. That the majority of entrepreneurs have a vision and they're doing it now. They have that vision, in 3 months it's going live, in 6 months it's going live. I didn't know how to work like that. I don't work like that. My thing is a planner. So, but what I realized as I was meeting entrepreneurs is that one, their day-to-day is their bread and butter. I have a day job. So it was a little bit lax, but one of the things that I was able to grasp in idea, vision, concept, market, is that the average planning should always be 9 to 12 months. And the thing that I like to use that I was using when I was in beta testing with my clients, because I had a lot of doulas in those, was, and they wanted to implement right away. And my question was, so if you had a client or if you were pregnant, would you want to have given birth at 7 months? Would you want to have given birth to your child in 3 months? Would you want to have given birth to your child at 8 months? No, no, no. So if your business is like your baby, why would you want to give it anything less than 9 months to actually grow and breathe before you let it, before it comes into the world, right? So that's a tool that I realized a lot of businesses, they're doing great. But the thing is that if we can begin to think about future and do all the many steps, one of the things that it does is it keeps us from going crazy. It eliminates, it creates a lower risk ratio in terms of you implementing and things going wrong, because you now you have time to correct and create mitigation plans. So all that long story, I apologize. Just to say that that's one of the main tools that I use and has been very successful for me in everything that I've implemented from my art gallery, because I did have a successful online art gallery with people displaying and selling people's work from different states and one sister in London. So it worked for me and it continues to work. And that's the business I'm in now, is teaching and helping people to get to that space. I call that a more grown up business space. Like, we're getting ready to step you into higher stilettos when it comes to that part. So that's one of my tools. And I'm going to turn it over to the sisters to see if you all have anything to answer in that. I know I that was pretty long.
Well, for me, what I want to say is, for me, when some of the tools I use in my business is being very impromptu and being just taking that risk at whatever time I take that risk. If I have an idea, I want to see it to fruition. And so I do some stages of planning, and whatever timeline I have to put it out, that's when I put it out. And usually I put it out right away, because I don't want to get caught up in any of the questions or any of the thinking that would delay most people. And so I put it out, and then I use that as a trial and learn from the experiences from that. And I like the momentum that is created from that, from being able to put it out and having it evolve and having the customers and consumers respond in a certain way from that just quickness of it. And I use Facebook and Instagram to do research. I use them to do research on consumer behavior. I pay attention to all kinds of things, things that people are interested in, things people talk about, patterns of, you know, what they may look at, what they may post. And I conduct that research for my business and how to market to a certain group of people, and what triggers people and what gets people, you know, amped up and things like that. And it was something else I was going to say that, I forgot. I'll probably come back to it later. But I just, and also another thing is that when I first started in my business with my clothing and everything, I did everything myself, from cutting to sewing to designing and everything like that. Up until recently, when this whole quarantine thing hit, I've had to hire multiple people. And that was such a relief to hire these people, to have them do, you know, everything that I would usually be doing, because it was such at a mass volume. And so now, from now on, I'm not going to be doing everything by myself, because it takes such a load off to be able to delegate tasks to different people, because you can't do everything by yourself in a business, because it will work for a certain amount of time, but not for a long time, and not with growth and everything like that. And so basically delegating tasks to different people, if you know you can do something that you can do it well, focus on that. But any other things like administrative tasks, delegate that to other people so that you can focus on what you're great at and delegate other tasks to people who are great at whatever they're great at. And so that's something that I'm utilizing now, and it's awesome.
Thank you. Any other feedback for Athena on that?
I would definitely like to speak on that. And picking back off of the last part of what Botany was speaking on, in terms of knowing, just being very honest with yourself in terms of your business and where you are, and knowing you can't do it all and you don't have to do it all. So if you are able to hire other people to delegate some of that work to, that's a really important piece, you know, an important part of your process. For me, I needed to hire a virtual assistant, and that was a learning experience for me as well. I went through 3 different assistants before I got that right. So I feel like when you think about hiring assistants, you know, an assistant or a staff, a team, whatever the case may be, the first and foremost, you have to be very clear about what it is that you need of them. what specifically do you need them to do, and then also have a budget in mind of what it is that you want to pay them. You know, those two things are very important before even reaching out to someone, because that was a learning lesson that I had to go through with my first two assistants. Like the first one, I knew I needed help, but I wasn't sure exactly what I needed help with, or even the amount that I wanted to pay them. So then with the second one, okay, I knew what I wanted, but I was unsure about the amount. So there was just that trial and error piece. So when you do reach out to get, you know, get some assistance from someone, start building your team, be very specific about what it is that you need of them, and then how much it is within your budget that you're willing to pay them. And it really just takes such a big burden off of you and makes everything just, you know, just flow that more magically, and you can conduct your business, you know, the way that you need to.
Yeah. Thank you, Zanetta. One other thing I just thought of as a tool in what Zanetta and Botany was saying about a team. I'm a Virgo, a hard Virgo, which means it took me a really long time, like probably close to 40, for me to admit this about myself. But I have a particular way in how I do things. And as a Virgo, I feel like people aren't going to do it right, not the way that I want it to be done. So it was always difficult for me to find someone until my business started growing and I couldn't manage it. And like Zanetta, I went through 3 virtual assistants. And one of the things I did, so this is a good tool. Zanetta, you have a good one now, but for all of us, this is a really good tool. I was at work and one of my projects required the hiring of some FTEs. Well, you can't hire anybody if you don't have a write-up, a posting for the position, what the position entails, what you expect for the position, what type of requirements you want the person to have, what type of abilities, you know, the times and stuff. And so this time, and then I realized, me coming from corporate, I have a particular way in how I do documents. And my virtual assistants weren't at what I required. So I got very specific. I was like, no, I need an executive assistant. I don't want a virtual, even though she's virtual, but I took virtual out and said, I need an executive assistant. And I wrote up I typed out a job posting and I posted it on Facebook. And I got like 6 people and I asked for resume. That's the other thing I did. I asked them for a resume. And 2 of them had nothing to do with what my job posting was about. So I didn't even interview them. I interviewed 2 other people. And one of the sisters, I mean, she just knew everything. And then what sold me is after we had that's the other thing I didn't do. I didn't really do interviews, not a real interview. So like I went on Google and like printed out an interview questionnaire. but after the interview, she emailed me notes from the interview. I was like, hired. So I just want to share my experience on that particular tool. Alicia, did you want to say something?
Yeah, something that helped me tremendously is automating things. So because I provide a service and it's tarot service, instead of having people emailing me and DMing me for readings, I just created a website on Wix, which is so good. I've done a website on other with WordPress before, but my website with Wix was very beneficial, especially for having a service, because I could just put in the times that I'm available and people can go ahead and they can choose the times that they want. So I don't have to communicate with every single person who wants to have a reading. And that took a lot of, it freed up a lot of my time. In addition to that, I have a Facebook page that's a tarot page. And what I used to do, like, obviously things have shifted, you know, in my life. But before, when I was more active on my Facebook page, what I would do is I would also automate my post. So I would have readings, but what I would do is I would take some time and schedule my day. Like, I have this amount of time to work on my website, this amount of time to work on my my post that I'm going to post for the week, and so on and so forth. So I would take a day and take like 2 hours and like post all the things I'm going to post for like maybe like 2-3 days in the week. And then I'll just, you know, schedule for when they're going to be posted. So then I take that time and do all that. So during the week, I'll get my post out and I don't have to do it on, you know, for the next 2-3 days. And so that was very beneficial for me, is automating and setting a schedule for myself, utilizing my phone, like my my schedule on my phone, my my alarm system, you know, the alarms and things like that, just scheduling an alarm so I can stay on it. Because as an entrepreneur, like, I'm setting my own schedule, and if I don't set times and actually plug in times where this is the time you're going to research, this is the time you're going to actually work on content, this is the time you're going to be dealing with people, this is the time you're going to be creating, then it kind of doesn't get done. Or I don't have enough time to do everything that I need to do. So automation and utilizing my alarm systems on my phone work wonders.
Awesome, thank you. One other suggestion I was thinking about, I meant to say before. I did this before, and I think Botany, Zanetta, you all have seen this. I had in my house, I had this, my previous house, I had an independent office. And so I had, you know, we have so many things in our brains that we have to get out. And pen and paper just wasn't doing it. Writing it in a computer just wasn't doing it. So what I did was I painted one area of my wall in chalkboard. And I had chalk. And what that allowed me to do is just to get out all everything, like all of my businesses. So like for retreats, I just wrote everything down. It was so fast. It helped. So here's what the tool is for that one, Athena and everyone on. What that showed me is that for those of us who are creators, visionaries, and are open to source, you get a lot of what I call uploads. And I'll call them down. I call them, they're uploads. They're coming up to our crown chakra from the soil. And it's just like, and we have all these ideas. So one morning I couldn't sleep. It was like 2-3 something in the morning. I was like, I went into the office, turned on the light, and wrote everything in my head on the chalkboard. And just to show you how certain tools we use in business also are applicable to life, is what I wrote out and eliminated from my head and then made space for new things was, at the time I was 44 or 45. I don't remember how old. I was 40 something. And I wrote out my whole life timeline up to the age of 65. Zanetta, I don't know if you saw that. Botany, I don't know if one of you guys saw that. And it was just all the major things, like the goals that I wanted to do before I was 50, what I wanted to do at 65, and how I was gonna get there, where I wanted my business to be. And if that didn't work out, what was mitigation plan A, part A, what was B, and what was C, and how much did I think it was gonna cost to get me there, and da-da-da-da, and da-da-da-da. And if this doesn't happen, then what? Like all of it. And then I went to sleep and slept like a baby. That was a fantastic tool. So I highly recommend, if you don't, find a wall, because a whiteboard isn't big enough for everything in here. You know, a post-it, one of those big post-it things, isn't big enough for everything in here. If you have the space to do it, find a wall, paint a chalkboard, or paint it white and have some glass put on it, and you can use it as like a big whiteboard of your own. Something that you have where you can get all of that stuff out. So that's what Alicia just walked over here and scared the crap out of me. I'm sitting next to a window. So that's another tool. So with that, Athena, what I'm going to do is I'm going to allow you to talk. You will have to unmute yourself. And let us know if any of those tools, you know, answered your question.
The reason why I asked this question is, as a business owner myself, I'm always interested to see and hear what tools people are using in growing their business. And I think that some of you ladies touched on what I was thinking, and I really appreciate everything that you guys had to say. I think where I'm at in business, I do have a full-time job, but I do have my business, which actually this coronavirus situation has been making it able for me to actually put more time into, and I've seen the work from that. But I'm still very much in the stage where I'm trying to get it to be what I can do long-term in the future. So I was just interested in hearing what tools you guys were doing, especially those of you who are doing it full-time, or to be more efficient within your business. But some of the tools that I've been using, social media has been great for me as far as like expanding. I also meant an expansion, not just, I guess, tools, but also marketing, like putting your business out there. But I think all of you kind of touched on that a little bit, but I just wanted to see what tools you guys were using so I can like grow my business in a more efficient and faster way.
Yeah, I heard her. So basically you say you want to grow your business more efficiently and quicker. I think it's just more about cultivating a brand that people can follow, that people can associate themselves with, and cultivating what type of, well, I don't know what type of business you do, but whatever it is, the main part of having your business grow more efficiently and quicker is just to cultivate a brand identity that people can associate with, that can separate you from other businesses and things like that. But in terms of the aspect of social media, definitely using all the tools on there, such as ads, Facebook ads, Instagram ads, you know, doing sponsored posts, as well as, you know, getting your network to share your posts and things like that to help it grow more efficiently. Or I'm not sure exactly what you do, but for me, that is what has worked. And just cultivating that identity has helped my, you know, business grow faster and more efficiently. So that's what I can say on that.
Hey, Athena, another thing too, this is another tool I forgot about. I have my clients, I have a tool worksheet that I use that's called an avatar worksheet. But thanks to Destiny, I'm no longer going to call it avatar. I'm just going to call it an ideal client list, or worksheet. What's unique about that worksheet? I learned a huge portion of it in a class that I took. It's like an interview with who your ideal client is. So if you could picture your ideal client, what does she or he look like? How do they wear their hair? How old are they? Are they married? Are they divorced? Are they single? How many children do they have? Do they not have children? What type of magazine? So this avatar, you answer, I think it's like 52 questions or 55 questions. But what with that avatar, what happens is when you finish, you're digging into the heart and soul of your ideal client. And what that does is it helps you with your copy. It helps you with your post. So from that interview, you start to highlight all of the issues that your ideal client, now, of course, you're making this up. So you're both the interviewer and the interviewee. So you're both the business owner and the client, and you're taking in these questions, but it's who your ideal client is in your head. Then you highlight each of that person's issues. Right? And then you take the top 5 or 10. I would take the 10. And for every issue, you write a response and how what your service is or what you do is going to help them transform that. Right? So then when you write your copy on your website, when you write your post, when you do things or what, anything in writing, the one thing that will separate you from everyone else is how you're speaking to your ideal client. Meaning, if I probably never wanted a tarot reading, I probably never wanted a whatever because I don't believe in it. But if I happen, not saying that I don't, I'm saying this is a potential client, right? But then I happen to just go on your website because I see your face and you, oh, she's attractive. Let me go see what her website, let me see what she has to offer. But not only are you offering tarot, but you ask, so let's say I can't sleep at night because I don't know what my tomorrow is going to be like. And let's say your website says, do you ever go to sleep not knowing what your tomorrow is going to be like? And the fact that you don't know how to plan for tomorrow keeps you up at night. I know how you feel. And you know what? My tarot readings will give you everything that you need to know for the next day so that you're prepared for that and have a nice rest sleep. You know what just happened? I don't even like tarot cards if I'm that client, right? But you just spoke to my heart and soul. I need that. I'm getting ready to click on something else. I'm getting ready to book a session with you. That is an amazing tool. When I say amazing, amazing tool, and I tested it out on my third retreat. And on my third retreat was the first retreat I had where I got my ideal clients, which were physicians, attorneys, anesthesiologists, IT engineers, people working in the software engineering at Google. Those were my clients. And when they were introducing themselves, I was like, they're my avatar. These are my ideal clients. It works. It works. So I do have that tool available. So for any of you who are on, it definitely takes time to fill out because it is like 52 or 55 questions. It can be a little bit hard to fill out too because you're making up your ideal client. A lot of time our ideal client are aspects of ourselves. So when we're answering these hard questions, you may cry. You may have to step back because I ain't ready to answer that, right? But when you do get to that and answer it, the thing is what makes that interview sheet so great, tapping into the soul. So what happens now is you're taking marketing to the next level, where generally corporate marketing is demographics. So in your market or your community, what's the demographics? You know, who are you? Blah, 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 blah. That's a broad audience. But when you start speaking, and most of us are in the healing work, the transforming work. When you start to speak to a person's soul in their heart, and you let them know you have what it takes for them to get out of this rut or this thing that they have, you've got the right client that's assigned to you now. So basically it's just like, so how I see it, and I see project management like this too when you apply it, how I see it is it's like just, it's dialing and punching in the code for your clients, a direct connection with your client who's assigned to you and you assigned to that client. That's what I love about that worksheet. It's powerful. So. Christina.
I just want to attest to that. That is absolutely true. When we first opened up our school, I poured a lot into who our ideal client was and who I wanted to collaborate with and who I wanted to help take themselves to the next level. And when we first opened up our business, we ended up working with someone who had been in the school industry for years. And she was like, yeah, you're never going to find that person. And I was like, yeah, whatever. Okay. Yes, I will. And when people go to our website, they're like, yeah, that definitely spoke to me. And that's why I'm here. And everybody they have a different mindset. They're go-getters, they're high achievers. They're on a mission to elevate themselves and to reach a goal.
So I just want to attest that that absolutely works. And so it's really important to put in that work in advance so that you are saving yourself a little bit of heartache.
Yeah.
Not working with the wrong people.
Absolutely. And so I'm going to say to all the ladies and brothers on the phone, in our meeting, and then all of us on the panelists too, like, your copy. And for those of you who hear the word copy and not sure what that means, your copy is your copyright. It's every word that you write that someone's reading. That's a copy. So your website, anything that you write in that website, that's your copy. It must be intentional. It must be targetful. It must be heartful. It must be soulful, because the eyes are reading that and it's telling a story and it's speaking to somebody. The most powerful tool, like Christina was saying. So we're kind of running out of time, and there was one more question from Tiffany King. And Tiffany, hopefully you're still on. Her question is, do you ladies have any suggestions to create the most comfortable, concentrated space for work? Also, are there certain rituals and items that's most helpful to create the most productive space? So I feel, to me, what created the most productive space for me, which is why I was so excited talking about it, was when I painted a whole wall in chalkboard from ceiling to floor. What that allowed me to do as a workspace and be more productive. When, like I said, again, when you can get things out of your head and put it somewhere where you can see it, like kind of like organized or in some type of a place, it's amazing what that does in your productivity. So that's my one main big piece on that. And then in terms of comfortable space for work, I don't know about y'all, but as a Virgo, I'm used to things being organized, and the more responsibilities that I got, I don't have the space to be organized. And I feel so like I need someone to tell me what I need to do to make a comfortable space right now. So what I do for myself is I sage or Palo Santo a lot, and I just speak to the ancestors and ask them to put me in a particular space. That's what I do for me until I'm able to change that. And so I'll see if any other sisters have any responses to that.
For me, what I do is I create and I design. So before I start the process, I always like to clean my space, like even after I finish one project or a dress, I like to clean the space again to create that new mindset to have, you know, the space just clear and calm and everything. And I always, you know, do a ritual of washing my hands before I even touch, you know, the fabric and certain things, just to make sure my mind and my body is clear. And even sometimes if I am working in the AM, I adorn myself a certain way to get myself a mindset of beauty, to get my mindset in the alignment of everything that my brand is about. And so definitely like cleaning my space, washing my hands, and you know, it's just all about cleaning and clearing the mind. And then even when I want to create in a certain manner, like create many things I want, I will keep the space full of things so that my energy can just go. Because that space is, you know, full of energy. So I just keep that space, you know, full of things. So it just goes, go, go. But I want to start over and start fresh. I just clear it out and clean it out. So that's what I do.
Awesome. Anyone else have any input?
I would love to speak about that. Mm-hmm. I think it's really important to have a designated area to work from. And keep that area clean. It's really important to keep your area clean just so that your creative flow can just be at its fullest power, right? You don't want a cluttered space, because a cluttered space leads to a cluttered mind and things just don't flow the way that they need to.
And then just also be very self-aware of yourself. When's your best time of working, and set aside that time to do your work. Maybe it's late at night after your family, you know, the house is quiet and you're able to just focus fully on your business aspects. Maybe it's first thing in the morning when you do your best work, but you have to figure out what that looks like for you. Maybe it's in the middle of the day. It's, you know, you just have to be very self-aware and see what your pattern is and when you're doing your best work. So definitely just have that designated space and keep it clear. And then think about what times of the day work best for you in terms of your working. And then another thing, like for me, I'm also a Reiki practitioner, and just with working with waste beads and crystals, I need to make sure that my energy is on high when I'm creating. I have to be vibrating on high when I'm creating, because I'm transferring that energy into my work and, you know, like into other women's wombs. So I'm always very mindful of my energy. And so sometimes I'll do a meditation first, if I'm not already on high. I'm saying these are things that I do. I meditate regularly, but if I really need to raise my vibration, then I will smudge with Palo Santo, because that brings abundance and joy and prosperity into the room. And it, you know, it can raise your vibration. I always have a lot of amethyst handy, so maybe I'll have some amethyst in my hand and I'll meditate with it again, just to raise my vibration, or even just deep breathing. Like that always helps. That always helps. But you really need to just figure out what works best for you in terms of different sacred practices and rituals to get you to where you need to be to do your best work.
Okay, I wanted to add something, but I'm not sure if you can hear me.
I hear you.
Okay. For me, in alignment with everything that the sisters were saying, when I do my meditation, I like to make sure that the four elements are represented. So I would light a candle. I also have like a little waterfall in my room, in my sacred space that I have designated for my brainstorming and my work. So I turn on my waterfall, I light my candle, and for fire, I'll either burn some frankincense and myrrh, or let's see, anything, an incense. But just to have like the ether, the fire, earth, and water represented, especially because the work that I'm doing is helping women move trauma through the body. So, you know, weaving the light and the sound through the body using movement. And another thing that I like to do is jiggle my booty, like shake all of that stagnant energy out and just kind of like shake and twerk the whole body, like just help to move that stagnant energy that gets trapped in our root chakra in our uterus, because that's where creativity begins. So if you're tight in that area and you're not moving that energy through, sometimes that blocks the flow of creativity. So if you turn some music on and just get to moving your hips, and just kind of moving that energy around, so that helps to clear your head, because that's where that creative energy lives.
Yeah. Also, I want to say something too, because yeah, with like what she said, with sitting a lot, sewing, and everything like that, sometimes my energy does get stagnant, and I will get tired, and I'll just have to put on some music and start dancing, and then that gets me amped back up and gets it flowing. So that's always a good thing to do as well.
Okay. Thank you, ladies. I am going to, Tiffany, I am going to give you, did I do it right? Okay, if you might be able to unmute yourself, if you want to just comment on any, if we answered any of your questions or hit some main points for you.
Absolutely, ladies. Thank you so much. That's a place where I've really, really been struggling in. I've kind of taken over my house. I've created like 4 or 5 spaces, and we have a 4-bedroom house, but I've taken over the house. And the crazy thing is that Each time I feel like I've gotten that perfect space, and I write. So being trying to concentrate on writing, I feel like I just need to do so much more, because I get stiff, I get stagnant. I have a yoga ball chair, I have a meditation pillow. It's just that sometimes it just gets shook up. One thing that I want to say that I really, really appreciate and I did not write down all of the ladies' names, I'm sorry, but the young lady with the glasses who spoke about having the elements present, I think that's something that I will implement, because a lot of times I will light my incense, but I feel like having everything, all of the elements there will probably help me a lot. But everything that you guys said was so helpful. Het Haru speaking about the washing of the hands and clearing out my space. I've been working for the last year on just getting my entire house in order, feeling like that was going to be the thing that would really, really get me moving. And also the young lady who spoke about knowing my best time for my work, which I find it comes late at night when I'm laying in the bed next to my husband. He has to get up early and I'll get an urge to write. And then I will stifle myself because I don't want to disrupt him. But those are some things that I really need to tap into. And I appreciate all of you ladies' feedback. Thank you so much.
Awesome. So we have other ladies on the line. And we have a little bit time left. So I'm going to allow everyone ability to talk. Can you please make sure that you see the microphone on muted. And so if there's anyone that has any comments or any questions that did not get a chance to speak or ask a question. Alicia?
I just wanted to add something for me when I to start creating. I always ask to be a clear channel and a clear vessel. I make sure that I have either my own sound bowl or I turn on Tibetan sound bowls when I'm creating, and I'm always in a constant state of prayer when I'm creating. You know what I mean? So I'm asking to be a clear vessel, a clear channel, so my ancestors can speak through me, so that they can work through me, so that whatever I'm doing, whatever I'm creating, whoever sees it, smells it, tastes it, touches it, or wears it, or experiences it, that it's for their greatest good and for their evolution and for their elevation and minds as well. And that is extremely helpful for me to set the space.
Awesome. Okay. Anyone on who would like to, and that's in the, that's a guest that wants to, or an attendee who wants to share an experience or ask a question or anything. This is your space. This is your sacred space.
Well, I will say thank you. Everything that I was able to hear, it actually really helped me. I am trying to build my business, and God has been blessing me with a lot of ideas, and just trying to figure all of it out. And the biggest thing for me was being hard on myself. I want to close my eyes and open my eyes and my business be up and running. So thank you for saying, you know, sharing your story about taking time to labor your business. Mm-hmm. And pretty much everything everyone has said that I was able to hear up to this point, it has really helped me. So thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that.
You're welcome.
So any other comments or questions or stories from, we want to hear from you too. We didn't spoke over an hour. And so if you do want to speak, you would just, next to your name should be like you should see a microphone with red. You can just click that to unread it, if you will, and then you'll be able to speak. Okay, while we're waiting on anyone who's on to do that, I'm just gonna share something for all of us who are on the phone. A lot of times we have visions and ideas that go unresponded to. And that could be out of fear. That could be out of not feeling like we're not going to be good enough. Maybe we feel like no one's going to patronize me. We'll have all of these things that ego or something near us is like dabbing at us and telling us all the reasons why we can't or why it's not going to be successful. So one of my main purposes here in this lifetime is to guide you back. Because when we come, we forget and we fall prey to all of the chit chatter. Chit and chatter. It's noise. And it messes with the brain, the mind, in this body, and we get all confused and then we start believing it. So one of the things I'll share, I used to share this all the time when I ended, when I used to host poetry lounges and I would end it, is, you know the saying that we're not perfect? As a little girl, I never understood that. As a grown woman, I don't believe it. And the reason why, if you look outside, every tree is perfect. Every flower is perfect. The sand and how it lays is perfect. The sky above is freaking perfect. The sun shining is perfect. The moon, the stars is perfect. And we're all itty bitty, bitty pieces of one big whole. And God cannot birth anything less than God. A dog doesn't birth a cat. A cat doesn't birth a dog. A bird doesn't birth a frog, right? So we are created in our perfect selves, with our perfect minds, with our perfect bodies, with our perfect visions, uniquely for exactly who you are in this one itty bitty piece of all the R's, right? So when you get this vision or this idea, and this could be hard and can take practice, but I encourage you to practice it. Please practice it. Move forward with your vision diligently, slowly, in divine time. And don't worry about who's going to patronize you. Don't worry about the output, because there's another thing that I always say. When you're using your hands to create, the healing in that creation is for you, right? You're doing something, you're doing it. But now once that thing is done and you've now put it out, that's no longer your invention. And you don't have nothing to do with that no more. Your job was to create from everything that's built up from your feet all the way up, uploading. And now you're outputting, out. Magic out, ba-dam. And all you have to do is sit, cross your legs, get your wine, water, drink, put it down, rest, and wake up to your clients. Once you output, that's no longer ours. It's for those who what we put out is healing for them. Who's gonna come to you to get what they need that your hands created and pushed out for them. So that is my gloryful message to leave with each and every one of us, because we do forget. I'm your guide. I'm here to remind you and I'm here to encourage you that any vision and idea you have, you can do it because it was given to you to do it. Don't listen to what other people say. Block out that chit chatter. Know that you are absolutely perfect and 100% who you are. God does not create anything less than perfect. The earth is not anything less than perfect. So that is my message to each of you. I am gonna close out now. Again, my name is Tamika Petrie with Tamika Petrie LLC. You have my website. I am going to post all the ladies on the panel today their information for you to have access to them too and patronize them and ask them questions. With anyone who's invited to Sisters in Business Table Talks, as an attendee, you never have to worry about bothering them because I do not associate with people who are one-minded or people who hold information. We are teachers and we are students of each other every day, all day. And that's the space that we provide. So again, I say thank you. I give thanks to the East, the South, the West, and the North, to air, fire, water, and what am I missing? Earth. Give thanks for you joining our circle. We're gonna take a good breath in for all of those elements and a deep breath in. And a deep breath out. And we're gonna come back to our sacred center and give thanks for protection, for love, emotion, experience. And we close our sacred circle. And I will that each of us go about our way on our journeys with our heads held up high, walking like goddesses on earth, communing, knowing that each tree and each plant is part of us. It's in our our veins, it's in our blood. We are all one. So whenever you see anything breathing or living, whether it's a spider or whether it's a fly, you are part of it. We are reflections of each other. And thank you for reflecting everything from us as we reflect to you. I say ashe, ashe, asheo, and I hope to see you again, and always feel free to reach out to me and any of my guests. Peace, love, and light to each and every one of you. Peace.